Now, let us discuss about Food Corporation of India and the restructuring of Food Corporation of India. It was given by Shanta Kumar Committee. So what it talks about? The first thing is, so let us divide the procurement, storage, distribution and transport. So with regard to the procurement, the first major questions are, at what cost we have to procure? Who will determine the cost? How much has to be procured? So these are the three logical questions which always comes up. So with regard to the cost of procurement, it is a commission for agricultural costs and prices. And next is, the organization which it is going to determine. And most of the times, it is politically influenced to determine the prices. In this context, the preference is shifting towards wheat and rice. And how much is the procurement has to be done? So with regard to the procurement, it is called open procurement policy, or else it is described as open-ended procurement. It means that how much of the grain is available, FCI has to procure that particular grain. So in this context, Shanta Kumar Committee says is this. So divide the states into well-performing and poor states. So in the well-performing states, this procurement has to be decentralized and given away to the states. So a decentralized procurement which is envisioned can be followed over here. And the second thing is, the payments to the farmers are determining. Next is, so the government need not procure the extra grain which is available with the farmers. Now, the government will recognize certain warehouses, and these warehouses will provide for the warehouse receipts, or these warehouse receipts will be used by these farmers towards getting a loan in the bank. So we can use the warehouse receipts or popularize the warehouse receipts. So which can be used by the farmers towards liquidity or gaining the liquidity. And next is, the government many a times, the state governments, they procured the grain which is fallen now for rain or some other matters. So this wet grain, etc., the non-quality grain shall never be procured. So these are about procurement. And once comes to the storage, so now we have to promote the storage units in the public-private partnership mode, and the privatization of the storage can be encouraged. And the grain which is stored, it has to be automatically liquidated if it crosses the buffer stock or it crosses the limited estimated strategic reserve. So what it says is, let us define something called as a strategic reserve. So the strategic reserve will be defined as some 5 million tons of grain plus the forex reserve which is necessary to buy another 5 million tons whenever there is a grain shortage. So the strategic reserve is not in the terms of the grain alone, but affordability to buy the grain from the open market, these two will be considered. And third thing is, so in the storage, we use instead of godowns. So near to the farm, we can build the silos. So in the United States, they store the grain in the silos. So even Madhya Pradesh has started this storing the things in silos. So that can be adopted in India too. And the next one is transportation. Yes, with regard to the transportation, the container system rather than the gunny bag system, this is what is recommended. And on the other hand, on distribution, so the leakages are very high. So end-to-end computerization is one thing which is recommended. And next one is, in the name of women, so a direct cash transfers to the family has to be given. So these are the two things which it has recommended. So with regard to the National Food Security Act, so according to him, it is highly unviable. So why is this unviable? So that reason is, it wanted to cover 67% of the Indian population, that is 50% urban and 75% rural. So in this context, it will be too much a burdensome on the government. So what he suggests is, So Antyodaya Anna Yojana, who are being provided with the grain, so they shall be continued further. But however, so I mean people beyond beyond BPL, so for them, so that they are called priority households, for them there is no necessity to provide for ₹3, ₹2, ₹1 per kg. It is better to be provided at 50% below the minimum support price. So it means that it decreases the subsidy burden on the government, and to the possible extent it tries to provide for this 5 kg grain per person. It did not talk about that it has recommended for 5 kg grain as per the National Food Security Act. These are the Shanta Kumar Committee's recommendations. So the procurement, how much it has to be procured? So it has to be in proportion to the strategic reserve defined. And the prices have to be scientifically determined, not politically. Quality grain has to be procured. And the open-ended procurement has to be stopped. And the second thing is storage. The scientific storage has to be brought in. And with regard to procurement, the decentralized procurement system has to be implemented immediately with regard to the well-doing states. In storage, negotiable warehouse receipts will be given to, can be given to the farmers. So these are the things. So now, with regard to distribution, the cash transfers is one thing which he has recommended for transport. So the leakage with regard to the gunny bags, which are leading for the rodents to eat away the grain, and also for the leakages while transporting, he tries to talk about the container-based transfers. So these are the things which are recommended. How a question can come over here? So the first question can be, what are objectives of the National Food Security Act? That is one thing. And the second thing is, so which of the following are Shanta Kumar Committee's recommendations? They may give you certain statements and ask for right or wrong in that particular area. Now let us see Hrudai. So that Hrudai, so it is launched by the Union Ministry of Urban Development. So what this means is, National Heritage Development and Augmentation Yojana. Under this, the 12 cities are identified, and these 12 cities will be provided with 500 crore funds for rejuvenation. And the major objective of the Hrudai is related to the attraction of the tourism. So now, what are the various places which are which are under the Hrudai program? They are Varanasi in UP, Amaravati in AP, Warangal in Telangana, and Ajmer in Rajasthan, Gaya in Bihar, Madura in UP, Kanchipuram in Tamil Nadu, Velankani in Tamil Nadu, and next is Dwaraka in Gujarat, Badami in Karnataka, Puri in Orissa. So these are the 12 cities under the Hrudai project which are launched. Next program is called Venture Capital Fund for the Scheduled Castes and Green Business Scheme. So what is this Venture Capital Fund and Green Business Scheme? Under the Green Business Scheme, 1 lakh rupees will be given for the poor scheduled caste people towards a financial assistance to start climate-friendly activities such as e-rickshaw, solar pump and solar energy. And the next one is a Venture Capital Fund Scheme. Under this, a financial assistance up to 15 crores per year to 6 years will be provided to 30 scheduled caste entrepreneurs in a year. So the total outlay of the budget is around 200 crore. The capital is 200 crore. Now, which is the nodal agency towards this? So that is IFCI is the nodal agency to operationalize this Venture Capital Fund. So this is what is the Venture Capital Fund meant for the scheduled caste. So the Green Business Scheme, this will give only less than 1 lakh rupees. Here 15 crore rupees per year. So to 30 scheduled caste entrepreneurs. And this will be available for 6 years. This is what is the program that is launched. The next thing is the Citizenship Act is amended. So previously we had persons of Indian origin card and overseas citizenship of India card. This overseas citizenship of India card, it provides for a permanent right to visit India and also certain other rights other than political rights. So this overseas citizenship of India will follow the, even the persons of Indian origin, they will be converted as overseas Indians now. So it means there will be only one category that will exist now. Now, and also new people are also being added to be eligible to acquire this OCI. So who are they? One is a minor child whose parents are Indian citizens. A minor child whose parents are Indian citizens. Or an overseas citizen of India card holder, or a person of Indian origin whose children also becomes the OCIs now. And the second thing is, any person who is married to an Indian, but do not take the Indian citizenship, also is covered under the Overseas Citizenship of India Act now. So these are the things with regard to the NRIs which have been brought in. So with regard to this year mains, they can ask you a question, because the voting rights for NRIs and also the providing for the citizenship, new citizenship rights, that is providing a new presentation over here. So that can, they're providing for new opportunities over here. So because of this, what the government is trying to provide for NRIs to invest in India, like that certain questions can become up, or they may narrowly ask it as economically and politically, what are the benefits that are being given to the NRIs to attract them towards India. So these are the specific questions can be asked for. Let us see some important decisions which are taken by the government this year. So let's see, in the power and natural gas, the government has deregulated the diesel prices, and with regard to the domestic gas pricing policy, it has taken up the Rangarajan, or modified Rangarajan formula was approved with regard to petroleum and natural gas. And the second thing is, with regard to agricultural, the high level committee on the restructuring of Food Corporation of India, that is Shanta Kumar committee, it has recommended to reduce the coverage of National Food Security Act from 67% to 40%, said that the 60% of coverage is unviable. And also for the priority sector, priority households, the cost of lending shall be at half of the minimum support price, not at a subsidized price of 3 to 1 rupees for rice, wheat and coarse cereals. And next is, in the telecommunication sector, the net neutrality is the biggest issue for this year. And onto the rural development, the government has issued the ordinances towards the Land Acquisition Act, and also Sansad Adarsh Gram Yojana, and next Rural Ban Mission. These are the various things which have been launched. So the Sansad Adarsh Gram Yojana, where an MP taking a village for development. And next is the Rurban. So that is rural and urban. They are together named as Rurban. And next is Rurban Mission. I'm going to explain all these things in detail, but overview I want to give you. So the Rurban Mission. And next, with regard to environment, the Subramanyam Committee, so constituted to review the environmental laws. We are going to see the recommendations of that. So with regard to the health, the government, it has tried to modify the Medical Termination of Pregnancy Act, and to tighten that particular act, that is later renamed as PCPNDT Act, to reverse the sex ratio under Beti Padao Beti Bachao scheme. And the draft national health policy and national mental health policies are proposed. And with regard to education, the government is trying to introduce new central universities. Already one central university has started in Bihar, and also the national planning and architecture, these schools have been declared as schools of national importance. And National School of Design in Ahmedabad, these are described as schools of national importance. In women and child development, we already saw Beti Bachao, Beti Padao. And next is juvenile justice care and protection of Children Amendment Bill 2014. So that is a judicial waiver with regard to the heinous crimes. And Law and Justice, National Judicial Appointments Commission, that is the important bill. With regard to the labor, apprenticeship, there is a flexibility brought into the employers to appoint the apprentices. And next is, with regard to the state issues, the Polavaram Dam in Andhra Pradesh, it is very much in the news. Now coming to the macroeconomic developments, the growth, the GDP at the constant prices was estimated at 7.4% for 2014 and 15, and also as the base year is revised to 2011 and 12, so the previous year's growth rates were also revised. That is, for last year it is from 4.7 to 6.9%, an upward revision has happened. And next is for inflation also, for consumer price index, the base rate has reviewed and the inflation has actually decreased and it even became negative on the wholesale price index. So in January 2015, the base year for calculating CPI inflation was revised from 2010 to 2012. So this is one change with regard to the base years. So with regard to GDP calculation, 2011-12 is the base year. From January onwards, for calculation of consumer price index, the base year is changed to 2012. Previously it was 2010. And next is the monetary policy decisions, because as we are in a recovery phase, the government is going through this policy rate cuts because inflation is very low. So in these circumstances, the inflation targeting was given to the RBI. So this year it is 6%, the next year it is 4% plus or minus 2. So there is a flexibility of 2 points over there. But the target for 2017 and 18 it is 4% under the inflation targeting. One is, the term repose are being provided for 7 days and 14 days. Now the to increase the liquidity, RBI is announcing them for 4 times in a month. So in this, the liquidity provided under term repose, it remained at 0.75% of demand and time liabilities. Similarly, liquidity under overnight repose, they remained at 0.25% of net demand and time liabilities. So 0.75% and also 0.25% for the overnight repose. And the cash reserve ratio, it remained unchanged at 4%. And next is balance of payment situation. It is highly positive. So under the chairmanship of Mr. Aravinda, the definition of FDIs and FIIs, they are going to be reshaped now. So we are going to discuss it a bit later. So with regard to the decisions regarding FDI, let us try to understand the changes which have occurred. In the defense, the FDI cap is 49%. So all the 49% will be through government approval route. So the cabinet committee on security, they will assess over 49% on a case to case basis. Even up to 49%, a governmental approval is necessary. But if greater than 49%, under special circumstances, if it is allowed, then it will be assessed on a case to case basis. And with regard to railway infrastructure, the total 100% FDI is allowed, and the total it is allowed under automatic route. And with regard to insurance, including FDI, FII, everything, it is 49%. In this, 26% is up to automatic route. From 26% to 49%, it has to be governmental approval route. And any infrastructure, it is 100% and it is automatic route. And next is pharmaceuticals, it is 100% and it is automatic route. These are the changes which have been brought in with regard to the FDI. Next, with regard to the budget, only I try to look at the deficits. The fiscal deficit targeted for 2015-16, it is around 3.9%, and revenue deficit, it is 2.8% of the GDP. Now, let us see the recommendations of the 14th Finance Commission. So now, vertical devolution from center to states, it is increased from 32 to 42%. With regard to horizontal devolution, so now we have to see what is the criteria for horizontal devolution. Next, what are the states, the general category states that are going to be highest benefited from this, and the special category states which are going to be highest benefited from this. and why the 14th Finance Commission recommendations are described as progressive. Because as state gets richer, the allocations have proportionately decreased. It means the weaker and poor states benefited more than the rich and established stable states. And on the other hand, what are the recommendations given by the 14th Finance Commission with regard to central state scheme, that is central sponsored schemes? So these are the things which we need to understand. So to understand the 14th Finance Commission report better, so try to see table 10.1 in your page number 131 related to the economic survey. So in this 2011 census, with regard to the population criteria, they are given 10% weightage for the horizontal devolution. And the total, the population weightage based on 1971 census, it was 17.5%. The total weightage given to the population is 27.5%. Previously, it was 25%. And next is the fiscal capacity to the income. So that is what is called as a fiscal distance. It was given by 12th Finance Commission, our fiscal, our income distance. So it was given 50% of the weightage. Last Finance Commission has given 47.5. So in this Finance Commission, the forest cover, it was given 7.5%, which was not at all given importance in the previous Finance Commissions. The area of the state, it was given as 15. Last Finance Commission has given only 10% weightage. So the fiscal discipline, it was given in the last Finance Commission around 17.5. Here it is 0. So fiscal discipline is not at all given importance with regard to the existing Finance Commission. So as the area and also the population still continue their weightage, and that is the reason why the larger states have got benefited better more than the smaller states. So in this context, what are the states which have got benefited among the general category states? So one is Uttar Pradesh, West Bengal and Madhya Pradesh. These are the best benefited states, UP, West Bengal and Madhya Pradesh, which are the largest states. On the other hand, among the special category states, the Jammu and Kashmir, Himachal Pradesh and Assam, these are the best benefited states in this particular category. Why this Finance Commission recommendations are called as progressive? The reason is the states which are, not well developed with regard to various indices, they are being given allocated the better financial allocations compared to the other states. That's why they are being considered, they are being described as progressive. The allocations are progressive. So, and what are the other recommendations given by the 14th Finance Commission? So, with regard to goods and services tax, it has recommended for a compensation for 5 years. So that is, in the first year it is going to be 100%, and the next year it is going to be 75%, and first 3 years 100%, next 75%, next 50%. But however, states did not agree to this. This has come for 100% compensation for 5 years. The fiscal deficit, it has said it has to be around 3% of the GDP, and with a flexibility plus or minus of 0.25%, and revenue deficit has to be zero. And on the other hand, if interest payments of the state, they are less than or equal to 10% of revenue receipts, the less than 10% of the revenue receipts, they shall be allowed to borrow up to the limit or additional limit of 10% of GSDP. So if that is, interest payments are less than or equal to 10% of revenue receipts, so we may allow them to borrow an additional 10% of GSDP. That is GDP. And next, these are the various things. So again, the definition of effective revenue under FRBM Act, that is the difference between revenue deficit and the grants for the creation of capital assets. So that is what is called effective revenue deficit. So it's recommended to do away with regard to the definition. So these are the recommendations. One more thing is, so with regard to central sponsored schemes, so for better consultative mechanism, the 14th Finance Commission has recommended for expansion of the role of the Interstate Council. So this is one thing. And next is, the central government also should use its fiscal space to address the states and the related fiscal deficit issues. The next is expenditure management commission is constituted. This expenditure management commission, who is heading this? This is chaired by Dr. Bimal Jalan, the former governor of RBI. The objective is suggesting how to meet the expenditure for development programs and also how to achieve fiscal discipline, efficiency, and other issues concerned with public expenditure management. So it is expected to give its report in mid of 2015. But however, expenditure management commission, it is chaired by the Bimal Jalan. And next is Security Laws Amendment Bill 2014. It was passed by the parliament. So what are the Security Laws Amendment Bill? So under the Security Laws Amendment Bill, it gives certain penal powers to the SEBI. So under this, collective investment schemes, these are being defined as if the pooling of the funds is more than 100 crores or above, they will not that are not regulated by law, they are called as collective investment schemes. The search and seizure powers are been given to the SEBI, and if a person who has involved with a fraud and where he is not interested to pay the necessary for defaults to the SEBI, then SEBI can order for confiscation of the property or can attach his property. And also the special courts will be constituted for the under the SEBI Act to resolve the disputes as soon as possible. So it means the Security Laws Amendment Bill, it is towards giving greater powers to the SEBI to conduct search and seizure and also explicitly attach the properties and to consent settlement between the parties and finally introduction of the special courts. And the other hand, the GST, that is 122 amendment bill, it was introduced in Lok Sabha. So under GST bill, what are the products that are excluded? That is in debate recently in the parliament. The alcohol is excluded. Next one is, who are the members of the GST council and what are the voting rights in this GST council? So the GST council consists of Union Finance Minister, the Minister for Revenue, our Minister of State for Revenue, and the ministers of all the states, that is the finance ministers of all the states, these are going to be the members of GST council. In the GST council, the center will have 1/3 of the votes and states will have 2/3 of the votes, but every decision it has to be made by 3/4 of the majority. So this is about the GST council which was constituted. So the exempted product, it is alcohol, because it was under discussion and some jokes have been made in the Lok Sabha. Now, with regard to GST, so GST, it is not a source-based tax, it's a destination-based tax. It means the states which have the manufacturing establishment, they may lose revenue. There are some apprehensions related to that. The GST is one country, one market, one tax regime. And it increases the compliance and also increases the better administration of the tax regime in the country. Under this, the state level and the national level, and next one is interstate GST. There are three things which are being administered now. Now, let us see how it is going to be administered further. And next is the bill, the black money bill, or it is called as the Regulation and Taxation of Undisclosed Foreign Income Bill. In this, Undisclosed Foreign Income and Assets Imposition of Tax Bill 2015, what it says is, every person, every citizen of India who has an assets abroad or income from abroad, he has to declare his assets and income. And failure to declare the assets and income is a punishable offense too. So in this context, the tax rate is 30% and there are no waivers applied to this particular income. And next is, there is one-time compliance opportunity. It means, if a person did not pay the tax till date, he can declare that voluntarily to the government and he can pay the tax and some penalty. And if there is a willful tax evasion, the punishment is for 3 to 10 years of imprisonment. And the second thing is, if the property of the individual is in some other country and equivalent amount of his properties in India, they will be attached. And the second thing is, here the non-disclosed income, it will be taxed 300% with penalty with regard to the, 30%, which is the original taxation. It means almost it's going to be 120%. And a failure to furnish results, it will attract a penalty of 10 lakh rupees and a rigorous imprisonment up to 7 years. So that's why the stringent measures are being available with regard to the disclosure of income assets. And next is regional rural banks. So with regard to regional rural banks amendment bill, so it tries to extend incorporation, regulation and closure of the regional rural banks, and the sponsor banks to RRBs can continue the period of 5 years, beyond the period of 5 years. A raising of amount of authorized capital is from rupees 5 crore to the 2000 crore. So these are the two important changes that have been brought to 1976 Act of RRBs. So there is a sponsor bank. So the sponsor bank can provide the assistance beyond 5 years. And the next is the authorized capital is raised up to 2000 crores. It means that RRBs, they can grow as full-time banks. And also RRBs can raise the capital from sources other than the central bank and state governments and from the sponsor banks. It means RRBs are being slowly exposed to the market. So this is one thing. And to give impetus to the Moody's make in India, so there are certain steps which are being taken up. The Law Commission has recommended for commercial courts in India with a separate appellate mechanism and also a quick adjudication of the process. This is one important step which has been taken up over there. The bankruptcy laws will also be reformed. So for bankruptcy law reformation, a committee was constituted. Mr. T.K. Vishwanathan is the chairman of this particular committee. So it has also given its interim recommendations. But however, for the prelims purpose, remember that Mr. T.K. Vishwanathan, he was the chairman of the committee which was appointed on bankruptcy laws reforms. So the commercial courts, bankruptcy law reforms. And next one is, to improve the financial governance in India, a committee was appointed that is called as a Naik committee. So the Naik committee on governance of bank boards, the public sector banks, this Naik committee was constituted. So what the Naik committee recommendations, this can be an important question. He recommended that the government stake in the public sector bank, it shall go into a bank investment company. So this bank investment company along with the public sector, along with the bank boards bureau, and next is the public sector bank board, all these three people shall have a role with regard to the appointment of the boards to the public sector banks. So these are the recommendations which are being given by the Naik committee. And with regard to private sector banks, he has recommended that the diversified investment funds, they shall be allowed to hold 15-20% of stake in private sector bank, and there need not be any regulatory approval for this. As of now, anything greater than 5%, any investment of funds greater than 5%, it needs a regulatory approval. So now it has increased up to 15-20%. So this is what is the private sector bank, what he has recommended for. And next is Dr. Aravind Mayaram committee. So the Dr. Aravind Mayaram committee, it's an economic committee which is based on redefining or rationalizing the definition of FDIs and FIIs. So the reason is most of the long-term investments are also being classified as FIIs in India. So with regard to this, what he has proposed is anything he recognizes less than 10% of stake in a company by a foreign investor is to be recognized as foreign institutional investment. So more than 10% stake has to be FDI, foreign direct investment. That is was recommended by the Aravind Mayaram. Along with this, all foreign investments or all existing investments made under FDI route, they will be considered irrespective of the level of the stake as FDIs. All foreign investments in the unlisted companies, they also shall be considered as FDI. And also, it has recommended that current RBI regulations that are restricting foreign venture capitalist investors, their investments to 10 crores, 10 sectors, that also need to be relooked. So that has to be extended to more and more sectors. And also, non-repatriable NRI investments, they shall be treated as domestic investments. These are the recommendations given by Dr. Arvind Mayaram committee. So these are the economic committees that are in the news this year. So let's recollect them. So with regard to the FDI, the commercial courts, it was recommended by Law Commission. So, and next one is TK Vishwanathan Committee on Reform of the Bankruptcy Laws. Nayak Committee, it is related to the bank boards. Dr. Arvind Mayaram, with regard to rationalizing the definitions of FDI and FII within country. So these are the various recommendations which are given. And next is, on the international front, Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank and New Development Bank, they can be the possible questions. So, New Development Bank, with a pooled up capital of 100 billion proposed by BRICS, the chairman was Mr. K.V. Kamath. And next is, with regard to BRICS, there is another thing which has come up, it is called CRA, that is Contingent Reserve Arrangement, to be used across the BRICS in the case of balance of payments emergency. It will be an initial size of $100 billion. And already I have discussed enough about the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank, so I'm not going to make it over here. So these are the things with related to the economy covered in. So where I have collected this information from, there is a PRS website. So this PRS legislative research, it has gives annual policy review. I always find two or three questions coming from this annual policy review. So I am giving this, and I mean these three issues which I have discussed, these are from this annual policy review. Thank you very much.